the second. If you would stand, our next song is "Tis This Week to Trust in Jesus."
Pastor Paul, tomorrow I'll make 43 years for Mary and Pearl, and how she put up with me this long, I don't know.
I'll never tell.
Yes, that's great. 43 years. Anyone else?
We had two successful surgeries this week. Michelle did great. Tisha's was a little bit more complicated. We found out on Tuesday if it was cancerous, but they went really well.
Okay, good, good. Also, Darlene Brawler, her hand surgery, it was successful. She was home, so you can remember her as well. She recovered from the hand surgery. Any others?
Mimi's actually recovering from hand surgery also.
Okay.
Doing well. We need prayer for Richard here. He's been not feeling good. Last night he was in a lot of pain and stuff, but still is. Has a lot of problems with that blood thing going on. And
yeah.
Need prayer for him.
Yeah, I remember Richard with the blood issue he's dealing with too much red blood cells. And so pray for him. Any others?
Praise for him. Praise for healing as far as Mom and I is getting over COVID, and then prayer that she can gain strength. She wants to get back to her own house and just get to her feet, so we're praying that that happens.
Yeah.
Calvin's brother Paul is home from everything, still mysterious about what's causing the blood loss, but the medication is happening.
Okay, good. Anything else?
On Tuesday, I don't know why this sticks out to me so much, but I just really felt like I was supposed to mention it. I just thought a woman coming out of Walmart talking on her phone, and she was very, very distressed and crying and talking about how could someone do this to her. And I don't know, but at the moment I saw that, I said, I need to stay, talk about this in church.
Yeah.
No idea what her story is.
Remember this one. Anything else?
My coworker, her mom isn't doing too well. She had red hospice care. So if we can remember the family right now, then it's pretty hard on all of them.
Yes. And Laura Lee said that her aunt had passed away this week, right? So remember that family in prayer as well. It's great for the one who's leaving, but it's not great for the ones who are still here. So remember them.
Remember the residents at Crystal Water. COVID is going through again.
Okay. Remember Crystal Waters. And Becky's surgery is scheduled for the day after Christmas, and she asked you to pray that they move it back, but somebody cancels. So that they can do it soon. They said they would if somebody canceled. So far, nobody's canceled. So she asked you to pray for that. Anything else?
The note from Linda McCracken.
Okay, yeah. Linda, I almost said Linda and Dick because it's in my head. Linda and Evan attended church. They were one of the ones who pulled out of United Methodist, and so they're independent now. The pastor they've had there has been there for a while, and basically they're on the verge of a split, is what she's saying. Pray that doesn't happen. There's a pastoral vote coming up for a year and a half, and then after the year and a half, he's going to retire. He's that close. And she's wanting him to continue, but there's half the church that wants him gone. And so she says, please pray that the church doesn't split over this. It's sometimes when you get your freedom from one thing, you want your freedom from everything. So please pray for this church. It's in Johnstown area. Any unspoken requests you have, the Lord sees those as well.
Jim? Well, she said that meeting is taking place right now.
Okay. So please pray for the church even now as they're going through this time.
If you would stand.
This morning.
I'm thankful for the husband I have.
Amen.
I get mad when he tries to treat me like a little kid and watch over me, but he's pretty precious to me.
Amen. Amen. Anyone else?
Grateful for family, especially God blessed me with a wonderful father and mother.
Amen. Amen.
I'm thankful for a body that can work, a mind that can think, a job that pays, and a family that loves.
Amen. 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 Anyone else?
I'm thankful for my family and especially for the extra kids that belong
to
me. I'm especially thankful for you, the pastor. You have some good messages that you hit with at home.
Someone else said something.
I'm thankful for where God has led me up to this point where it's
teaching me. Amen. We're thankful God led you here too.
I'm thankful for God's grace and His mercy and His love for each one of us.
Amen. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for all these many things, and for those who didn't want to speak out, Lord, may they speak out to you now, Lord, in their hearts and their minds, and just tell you what they're thankful for. This Thanksgiving season, Father, remind us again that we don't have to complain about everything. We don't have to have everything our way, but we can be thankful for the things that you've given us daily. Father, we thank you that we live in a country where we can come and worship, Lord, where we want to. We're not worried about some gunman from the government coming in and shutting us down and perhaps killing most of us or putting us in concentration camps. But much of your church around the world is facing that every single day, every single worship time they come together. Father, help them as well, Lord, a persecuted church around the world. Father, we pray that you would hear our thanksgiving for the surgeries you've brought us through, Lord, this week, Father, the way you've helped Darlene and Tish and the other ones who have gone through surgery. Thank you for what you've done with Debbie. Continue your healing, Lord, upon their bodies. We pray for Dick, Lord, you continue to help him as he's facing treatment seemingly again and again and probably seems endless to him. Give him special grace, Lord, to be able to go through this. May he have his eye on you, Lord, and trust you through the process. Father, we thank you for all that you've done. So many things. Thank you for helping Helen get out of the hospital, Lord, and Sandy and Ray get through their sickness, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you give our bodies a way to recover. Thank you, Lord, for each person to find hope in you. Thank you for this lady at Walmart that needs hope, Father. May she find it in you, Lord Jesus, as we bring her before your throne. We pray for Becky's surgery, that you'd move it up, Lord, like only you can do. And we pray for the others who are facing surgery. Just be with them as well. Help Crystal Waters as they battle through another round of COVID, Lord. And we pray that you would take away the fear and just give them your peace, Lord, as they're there needing your touch. Praise you for all these things that we have mentioned, Lord. For all the unspoken requests, we lift them before you. Holy Spirit, come and guide us in this time. Let us worship you, we pray, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
Amen.
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 Amen. You may be seated. Corinthians chapter 1, I'm going to come back to one primary verse tucked in two others to grab something. It's not a typical Thanksgiving message, but it's one that I think we're supposed to get to that we haven't yet. About if you continue in the faith. If you continue in the faith. So that's a question mark. Probably one of the biggest words in the Bible or any place else is if. We've seen the great promise of being stood before God without blemish, without spot. And he goes on to say, if you continue. And so we're going to look at that. Here's somebody who didn't continue. Go ahead and run the next slide. Anybody recognize this guy?
Antonio Brown. That's Antonio Brown now. His uniform. We are told, and that is jersey, and running out of the field, I don't know if that could have been a penalty.
All right, Janelle, get after that. We don't know what's going on there.
She's going to catch it first. Jimmy Eagle. He's having his issues off the field. Now he's on the field creating an issue. Well, pass, hauled it in, and good enough for the first down.
Guys, very odd situation.
Enough was enough in Pittsburgh, wasn't it? And the way he went. So let's look here at this scripture about if you continue. He didn't continue the game. He said, I'm out. Right in the middle of the game, just took off his jersey and his pads and threw them down and left. So let's look at this scripture then. Verse 21 says this. He's talking to the Colossian people. Remember who he's talking to. He's talking to a church that he's never met, but he knows their pastor, and the pastor has told him his story. He said, once, in other words, in the past, you were alienated from God, and you were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now, he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body, and we'll get back to that, Christ's physical body through death, to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, free from accusation. If, let's all say that, if you continue in the faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out to you in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard, that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. And he says the similar things as Paul writing again to the Corinthian church, not the Colossian, but the Corinthian church. And he says, now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel which I preached to you, which you received, and in which you stand, and by which you are being, present tense, being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preach to you, unless you believed in vain. The gospel, remember, is very simple. It's the good news. The gospel, in a nutshell, is this, that the Son of God, Christ Jesus, died for sinners, amen, that they might be forgiven. That's the good news. And have eternal life, to live forever with God in heaven. Father, we pray that you'd help us to understand this, help us to grasp it. For way too many have accepted the gospel, followed the gospel for a short while, ran the race for a while, and then some place along the way decided no longer to run. And like Antonio Brown, they just walked off the field of life and following Christ and gave up. Father, help us today to hear what you have to say. And receive your holy communion, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. There's three things he says here. First of all, he's telling them that you have to get started. You can't win the race unless you're in the race. In NASCAR, there's usually 43 cars, sometimes 37, that begins the race. But you've got to get in the race. I could take my little Hyundai down there to Bristol, but they wouldn't let me on the track because I'm not a racer. I'm not one of theirs. You have to get in the race. And so there has to be something happen. I'm not even close to a race car driver. My car's not even close to a car that can run. And so something would have to drastically be transformed for me to ever get in the race. And that's what Paul was saying here. He's saying, Colossian church, you were once not in the race. You were once on the sidelines. You were alienated from God. You were enemies of God. You were far away. That's what he says in verse 21. Once you were alienated, you were enemies because of your evil behavior and your thoughts. And so he's saying that's where you were. So what happened until we get to the next verse is because he says, by Jesus' own body, who died for you, you put your faith in what God did, and you are now transformed. You're a part of the body of Christ. So you started the race. You got into the race. You weren't even eligible for the race until you put your faith in Jesus, and now you're in the Christian race. You're running it like NASCAR, starting on the starting line. But the problem is, of 43 cars that start, some of them have a DNF. Did not finish. And so you can go in the race, you can be leading for most of the laps, but then something can happen. The motor blows, the transmission goes, the brakes overheat, and you find your car back behind the wall and not finishing the race. And that's sad for a NASCAR driver who loses millions of dollars, but it's far more sad for those who have once walked with Jesus and who had a home in heaven and were following him, and then all of a sudden, for some reason, they got out of the race. They were in it, they were started, they did well, like the Colossian church, but Paul wants to warn them, not only do you need to get in the race, you've also got to overcome obstacles. You've got to overcome whatever problems come your way. In NASCAR, you've got to overcome getting too close to the wall and skinning it up, or you've got to overcome all kinds of things. Now, the Colossians' problems aren't probably the obstacles that we face, but their church was began by a convert of Paul's named Epaphras, and he got saved, no doubt, in the Ephesus church, which was 100 miles east, or I think west, I guess, because the Colossian church was 100 miles east of Ephesus, and their pastor got saved, went there, probably started that church. But some problems had come in. There was some false teaching come in, what they called Gnosticism, which basically means that all matter is bad, all spirit is good. And so, if matter is bad, this body is bad, then Jesus could not possibly have come in a physical body. He was only a spiritual body. Because matter is bad, and the sinless Son of God could never be in matter. And so that's why Paul says to them, again, we don't know exactly what their problem was, except what Paul was saying. Yes, he did. Jesus came in a physical body to die on the cross. He wasn't a spirit who could come and die on the cross and say, well, he never really felt what we did because he don't have nerves. He don't have blood that can be spilled. It's a spiritual body. He didn't really suffer like we did. And he said, oh, yes, he did. He came in a physical body because the body by itself is not evil. Christ died in a physical body. They had some other problems of mixing this religion and that religion, a little bit of Judaism, a little bit of Christianity, a little bit of this was all coming in, and Jesus isn't really the most important anymore. He's no longer central. And that's why Paul said in the first part of the chapter that Jesus is supreme above everything. And then he was trying to get them back on track, that Jesus was the only one. We can worship angels. No, you can't. They were created by him. Jesus alone is to be worshipped. They had to overcome those obstacles, all the problems. Because obstacles often make us want to quit, to give up. And spiritually, you can't give up. We've seen it in sports in many situations. Think about those who quit in the middle of an event. My favorite, I guess, is I was a big boxing fan. Back when boxing was on TV and was pretty popular. Sugar Ray Leonard was my favorite fighter of all time. And so, as a young boy, I would try to be like his flurry. And he could hit you six times before he stopped. He was just so fast and so powerful. And then he faced Roberto Duran. And, you know, Sugar Ray Leonard fans all thought, it's going to be easy, no problem. This guy is nobody. Well, he lost. Roberto Duran beat him around and got into a street fight and he lost. And so that was in 1980, early part of 1980. In the 6 months later, in June of 1980, they had a rematch between Roberto Duran and Sugar Ray Leonard. And I always remember this, is they got into the fight and Sugar Ray was really going well. And about the sixth round, he was doing so well on the cards that he started to do just making fun of Duran. And he was winning so well that finally put a barrage of his flurry upon him. And Roberto Duran says those now infamous words. You know what it was?
No mas.
No mas. No mas. No more. No more. I quit. And in the middle of the fight, he was behind, but he hadn't lost, but he did lose when he quit. He quit. No more. And so there's obstacles in our spiritual life. It's one thing for him to do that, or Antonio Brown, who quit in the middle of a game and cost himself $1 million on his contract. And that's sad if you really want $1 million, which most of us wouldn't mind. But it's even sadder when you give up heaven for some trinket on earth. Some little thing, some little obstacle to get you off track. We must overcome the obstacles. We can't quit. You may remember, I also remember the Mike Tyson. He was the most feared fighter in America for quite a while until he finally got beat, and then he wasn't so feared. But he had won 50 fights and lost 4. And he was in a fight in which he, about the sixth round, he was fighting really a nobody. But he was so exhausted, he ended up the round on the canvas. Finally got back in his corner, sat on the stool, and never came out. He said, I'm done. Never came out, he's still in the fight. And said, just like Roberto Duran, no loss, except he didn't say it that way, but I'm not coming out anymore. I'm done. And I wonder how many people who started for Jesus and started serving him, but something happened, they had a loss, or he didn't answer a prayer, or something bad happened, or some tragedy struck their life, and they blame God, and they no longer serve him. They walk away. We must start in the race and get started. We must be transformed even to do that. But then we must overcome all obstacles that come our way. And the most important, he says, is if you continue. You must overcome the obstacles. You cannot quit. The only way you're going to overcome, the only way you're going to win, what's the saying in sports? Winners never quit, and quitters never win. Exactly. And so, you know, many times we are tempted to quit. Many times we're discouraged. Many times we want to give up. Begin to think about those who came back in the NFL. The greatest comeback, I believe, just a few years ago by Kirk Cousins in Minnesota. They were down about 4 touchdowns with like 5 minutes to go in the game. And the chances of coming back were almost nothing. It would have been easier just to mail it in. Say, we ain't got a chance, just to face this game and just get our check and get out of here. But they didn't quit. For some crazy reason, they kept playing. And in the last 5 minutes, Kirk Cousins threw 4 touchdowns. And the Vikings overcame that huge deficit and won the game. The only way you're going to win the Christian life is if you don't quit. And I promise you, there'll be times you'll be tempted to. There'll be times when obstacles seem too big. I mean, around the world where some, they've come in and taken your house. They may kill all your family but you. Will you still serve Jesus after that? That's an obstacle that seems really big, but we can't quit. We can't give up. We only win if we don't quit. And he says there in verse 23, if you continue in the faith, established and firm and not moved from the hope, then, what was the promise? In that verse before that, Christ was reconciled to you, reconciled by his physical body through death, to present you. Think about this, you. God's going to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, without sin, free from accusation. What a great sin before God, and there's no accusation. Every sin's been forgiven. And he says, that's what's going to be. That's the promise. If you continue in the faith. An old preacher that I knew somewhat, my friend was really good friends with him. He made this statement. He said, if you become a preacher, your chances of going to heaven just went down 50%. That you're going to have a target on your back from Satan. Now, I don't know if that's true. That's not from statistics. That's probably just from his personal experience of watching many who walked with God somewhere along the way quit walking with God. They did it for a while, but somewhere they quit. Somewhere they gave up. So I challenge you this morning to continue. And the other way you continue is time after time, getting on your knees and say, Jesus, I blew it. Forgive me. Let me start over. Take away my sin. Give me a new start, a new beginning. And he always does. And communion is one of those times that really helps us to do that. Because Jesus, when he was going away, said, I'm not going to be here, but I want you to remember the most important thing in life. And that is the cross. The cross where I died, where you should have died. Where I took your sins that you should have been killed for. And because of that, I offer you eternal life. And so he asked us it's a physical thing that we do, but it's got to be spiritual as well. There's no value in just taking the cup and eating this by itself. But by faith, he says, on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took the cup and the bread, and he blessed them. And he said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me, and you remember the bread as when my body, my physical body was broken, torn apart by the scourge, the blood was pouring out. I had a crown of thorns on my head. Remember, I did this for you. And I'm willing to give you a new start. Or I'll even transform you and get you in the race if you've never become a Christian. He says, you're not worthy, you're not able, all are sinners. But I can transform you this morning by putting your faith in what Jesus did. Not what you did, not being a better person, quit doing bad things. That's nice, but that won't get you in the race. It's got to be Jesus supernaturally transforming a heart.
Amen.
And he can do that by putting our faith in him. So we're going to have a time of communion after I pray. And it's one we don't want to use musicians. We have a video presentation by Marty Nystrom, a worship leader from Hosanna. I've only done this one at a time in 40 years of ministry. And then it was with a cassette. So I'll tell you how long ago it's been. But new technology is much better. You can sing along with the songs. And I want you to have this few minutes of focusing on what Jesus did and how that I can take this. Not everybody should take it unless you really want to remember and you want to receive what Jesus did for you. If you spiritually say, I believe that Jesus died on a cross for me. I believe that he can take away my sins and give me a new start. No matter how bad I mess up. One of my good friends spent 20 some years in a penitentiary for killing a man. But every Sunday he stands in my home church and plays his guitar and sings to the glory of God. There's no place that God can't forgive and give you a new start. It's all because of what Jesus did. Heavenly Father, we ask you to take these elements, Lord, that are just natural. And we ask you to transform them into something spiritual, Lord. As we take them, may we truly remember the pain and suffering of your body. And it wasn't for yourself, it wasn't for your sins, it was for ours. We pray that you would remind us as we take the cup, that you would consecrate these into becoming spiritual things, to remind us that the blood of Jesus, the Son of God, came to die and spill his blood that I could go free.
Hallelujah. Praise you, Father. When we've messed up so bad and we have no hope, we look into your eyes at the cross and we know that you're making all things new. You forgive. You give us all these things. In the name of Jesus. We'll have our ushers come. I want Silas and Samuel come. They're going to take the bread first. I want to give you the bread first because in this they're going to take the bread first. And so I want to get that passed out as quickly as I can. But I need the other ushers to come back up and pass out the cups after that as well. Get one side. Just hold it until we get ready to take it together. Brother ushers will come. Brother ushers come and pass out the cup.
Thank you.
down Dave a minute.
The same Apostle Paul wrote these words early in his life, late in his life, about to die. In a prison cell, he knew he was going to be beheaded by Nero. Pen these words. The time of my departure is at hand. I fought a good fight. I finished the course. I've kept the faith. Henceforth is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, but not only for me, but for all those who love his appearing. The Apostle Paul, even himself, had to say, I started the race, but I also finished. I'm about to die, but I've continued. The scripture says, if you continue in the faith, we will stand before God without accusation. If you continue, don't quit. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would make this a holy moment before you as we have received your blood and your body. And Lord, may those who for the first time have put their faith in you, when Satan puts accusation in their minds to say that they're not transformed, they're not different, may they bring him back to this place, in this church, at this time, when they chose to follow you. They put their faith in you and ask for forgiveness. Lord, may you forever etch this on their mind, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can put the cups, put one back there, and I'll have this.